Point Blank is a crime fiction podcast. It may not be suitable for all listeners. We discuss violence in all its forms. The works we reference may include period slang, which some listeners may find offensive. The hosts also have a tendency to swear.
Episode 6, The Real Cool Killers by Chester Himes. And welcome to Point Blank. This is episode 6, the return to the lost episode. Episode 6 was initially lost by the technical gremlins. So here we are in an effort to record it again. How are you doing today, Justin?
I'm doing well today. I'm looking forward to revisiting Chester Himes. The benefit of having to redo this episode is I got to reread the book and think through some of the thoughts I had about the initial. Chester Himes and his work is growing on me.
Well, that's good to hear, because I know the first time around you didn't have those same feelings necessarily.
No, and I'm not going to veer too far, but just another notch up the ladder. I feel like I understand some things a little more clearly now about him. Also, I saw Star Wars The Last Jedi. It's been out for a while now, and I really am pleased that it was good. Actually, I don't just like it. I think I love it.
Well, that's good to hear. I saw it as well, and I have to say it is up there with certainly my top Star Wars films. I need to see it again before I give it that final rating, but yeah, I think it's in the top three for sure.
I had it in the top three, four upon first viewing, and after second viewing, it moved up to top two. It's hard to beat Empire Strikes Back for me. This comes close. I think it has the emotional gravity, the balance of humor and powerful action scenes and character development. I really think Rian Johnson hit it. And for all the naysayers out there, I don't understand that stuff. I think that any story that gets pushed into new directions and challenges viewers' ideas and thoughts and preconceptions, I think that those are generally smart, provocative, and important moves to make. And something is static and mythological as Star Wars, it's dangerous to be afraid to shake things loose a little bit and push it into new territory. And The Last Jedi definitely moves into new directions in a way that I think is refreshing and what I want in any story, crime fiction or sci-fi.
I would agree too. I mean, I don't understand the naysayers on this either. I mean, if they're, you know, really need to have Lucas doing a film, all they need to do is look at one, two, and three, to discredit that notion. When a property, especially something as big as Star Wars, you could say the Lord of the Rings as well, certainly some of the crime fiction characters that we have as well. Let's say Sherlock Holmes, for example.
Sure.
Once that gets so ingrained in culture, like, give it to some other creators, and sure, you're going to get some duds and you're going to get some excellent stuff, fresh minds. I mean, we're talking directors now who grew up on Star Wars and have been probably quietly at night jotting down storylines that they hope to do one day for decades. And now there's an opportunity to actually do that. So I see it as only making the universe bigger and better. And if we have to endure a couple of Star Wars duds of films, that's fine. I mean, look at the Marvel universe. There's some excellent films in there and there's some crap.
Yeah, I look forward to what they do with the rest of the series, and I'm just relieved that this middle film exceeded my expectations.
Speaking of the screen, there's a couple of things I've been watching that I think our listeners are probably already aware of, but if you're not, I wanted to go ahead and mention two shows. One is, and this one is relatively new, but it's on Netflix and it's Mindhunter. I'm not actually sure if it's supposed to be a multiple season show or just a single series, but what it covers is the FBI agents in the 70s who were essentially doing a study on serial killers and putting together like the psychological and sociological profiles of serial killers. And it is very well done. I like the fact that it really keeps its narrow focus on just a couple of people who were involved in this. We don't get into bigger FBI issues and all of this. Really, it's a bunch of series of well-acted scenes between the FBI agents and people playing these notorious serial killers who they go and interview. And people can argue about law enforcement and what they do back and forth all the time. But I think if there's one thing I'm sure all of us would like to see stopped, it's serial killers. really gets into that behavioral science of profiling, which has pluses and minuses to it, but it's an interesting series nevertheless.
Don't speak for everybody about serial killers. Sure, they're despicable, but then, you know, they have their merits.
Okay. Moving on, another show that I am very late to the party about here, but I think so far it has some of the best crime writing that I've seen on television lately, and that's the show Ray Donovan. And I know a lot of you are saying, oh my God, I can't believe you haven't watched this yet. You know, it's funny with different streaming services and everything, the way we get our media these days, if you don't have certain subscriptions or whatnot, you just might not have access to different shows. So this one's relatively new to me, but man, I just love the writing. I love what they're doing with it. Basically, it follows the Ray Donovan character, who's a fixer in LA for like movie stars. And that's not even the most interesting part of the show, because it's all connected to these corrupt lawyers, and they're connected to the Boston mob. And Ray Donovan's family is very connected from the days in Southie, and they all move out to LA. And in the very first part of the show, the dad comes back from 20 years in prison for a crime that, you know, he probably didn't commit, even though he committed plenty of other crimes. And there's a lot of family mystery elements to this, but just solid writing, a lot of, I don't want to say cliche, but a lot of tropes that are pretty familiar to crime fiction fans, mm-hmm. but done in a way that feels fresh and interesting.
That's the key, isn't it? How to make these tropes feel fresh. And it's not always easy.
Yeah, for sure. So anyway, Ray Donovan and Mindhunter, highly recommended.
Cool. Moving on. Jinx.
Moving on to our five round burst for this episode. Five round burst is where we do five reviews in about 5 minutes. And we got a pretty good selection this time around. First up, Ross McDonald, The Moving Target. This was originally published in 1949, and I read the Black Lizard edition. This is the first Lou Archer novel. And many people say that McDonald is the heir to Hammett and Chandler. And I definitely see this in this book. It's got that LA area detective. It just hits on all fronts, really. I enjoyed the main character. I enjoyed the story. We have a lost millionaire in Southern California who Archer has to find. We get involved with a holy man. There's astrology involved and an S&M club as well. So this one is all around a hit. We are going to talk about Ross McDonald in an upcoming episode. So I can't wait for that episode based on my reading of this book. Up next, we have Nobody Move by Dennis Johnson. This came out in 2009. By Picador Books. And Johnson is kind of known as a writer's writer, and he recently passed away in 2017. And this is his foray into the crime fiction genre. He doesn't write exclusively in one genre. He's one of those authors that uses different genres to play with and experiment with. And this one follows Jimmy Luntz, who's a degenerate gambler who owes money and then has to go on the run. And then, of course, he runs into a bombshell named Anita, and then adventures ensue. This one is kind of a near miss for me. Maybe if you're familiar with Dennis Johnson, you'd be more interested in reading this. I guess playing with the genre didn't quite work in this case for me. So anyway, that one's a near miss for me.
It sucks to hear that book didn't work for you. I haven't read it yet. It's still on my shelf. But Dennis Johnson is one of my all-time favorite literary writers, and Jesus Son, his collection of short stories, is in my top three books of all time, particularly of short stories. I read one of his novels set in Africa. It was supposed to be like a ripoff of Graham Greene, and a lot of people criticized it. And I liked elements, but it did feel a little hackneyed. And maybe when he wanders into genre territory, he loses his footing or something, because that's what it sounds like from your review.
Yeah, I would say so. I mean, there's elements here that I enjoyed. I can definitely see trying other parts of his fiction, because there's elements there that I really enjoy that, again, this one just didn't work. Okay, for our third book, we have Cop Hater by Ed McBain. This is one of the 87th Precinct novels. And again, if you're a big crime fiction fan, you probably are already familiar with Ed McBain. But this one came out in 1956. It was republished in 2012 by Thomas and Mercer. And these are raw, gritty police procedurals. There are a ton of these 87th Precinct novels, and there's a reason why they sell. This was good. I enjoyed it. I'm not normally a fan of the police procedural, but because this one focuses more on that precinct and not on a specific detective character, I think that's one of the reasons why it worked for me. The basic storyline here is that someone is out shooting cops from the 87th Precinct, and they have to figure out who's doing it. So I really enjoyed it. It's got a great feel. It's very hard boiled. It's a hit for me. Next up, we have an anthology collection, Send My Love and a Molotov Cocktail, Stories of Crime, Love, and Rebellion. This came out in 2011 from PM Press's imprint Switchblade. And this is another one of those collections that does a nice job of just giving different voices to the table. One of the reasons I like crime fiction, ton of different perspectives, all of them loosely under this umbrella of times of essentially revolt or politically motivated crime in here. It's a pretty solid collection. I think if that basic description is something that catches your fancy, this is a hit for you. Maybe if that doesn't excite you, it might be a miss, because there's a few really solid stories in here that make it worth picking up, but then there's a few duds in here too. That's Send My Love and a Molotov Cocktail, kind of a mixed bag. And lastly, for our nonfiction selection for this episode, we have How to Steal the Mona Lisa and Six Other World-Famous Treasures. This came out in 2016 from Penguin Random House. And I'm just going to say right off the bat, I think this is a miss. I'm not actually sure why I picked this up. I guess I thought that it would be maybe a little bit more based in reality of analyzing like different burglary techniques or something like that. But this is kind of one of those how-to parody books, like, you know, how to survive a crocodile attack. It really doesn't get into enough detail to be worthwhile. A lot of this stuff, if you actually spent 5 minutes thinking about it, you would have the same ideas. It's a miss, so you can skip How to Steal the Mona Lisa and figure it out for yourself, I guess.
I was under the same impression as you were when you read the title. I figured it was going to be some kind of burglary techniques book. Apparently not.
Well, there's enough books out there that are kind of like how a certain crime was committed. I've read a number of ones on various art theft or historic artifact theft that do get into the intricacies of some of these things and how either the security devices were circumvented or whatnot. And they don't necessarily get into great detail, but it does tell you like practically how somebody did it. And I find that interesting, you know, just as a reader of crime fiction, just or someone looking to write crime fiction, you want to get it as real as possible. And sometimes it's not like some master thief descending from the skylight. It just happens to be somebody timing the maintenance guy right and walking in dressed as a janitor and walking away with a painting.
Sure, practice makes perfect with everything, I guess.
Indeed. Well, moving on to our main topic. Today we have Chester Himes' The Real Cool Killers. And Justin, what did you think of the book? Your initial impressions?
Okay, so when we recorded this episode a few months back, I had a lukewarm relationship with the book. It was the first Chester Himes I'd read, and this is the second in the Harlem cycle, the first being A Rage in Harlem, which we didn't read for today. And I gave this 3.5 kill shots, and I had some criticisms. Now, my view has changed slightly, and, you know, reading this again, in the first 20 pages, I'm still not deeply impressed by the gratuitous slapstick violence. But I held on hoping that the story would settle over time and we'd get more character development. Now, I feel like we do. And I feel that having read A Rage in Harlem first to understand some of the characters a little bit better, it really helped me to value The Real Cool Killers more than I did the first read. And I would give this a 4 kill shots. I think it's a solid book. There's some really strong stuff here. I think that Chester Himes is groundbreaking when it comes to dealing with, well, detective fiction as an African-American man, but also how he deals with racial injustice in America, which just wasn't something discussed in the hard-boiled. As we know, having read quite a few and reviewed quite a few books, race isn't something that comes up unless it's racism. And in this case, I really like what Himes is doing. The book is solid, and it's not my favorite, but overall, I think that Himes is a rock star, and what he does for African America and what he does for African detective fiction and what he does for detective fiction in general is huge.
Well, I'm glad to hear that your rating improved a little bit with some time, because when I initially rated it, I had given it for me personally, it's a 5-star book, but I couldn't distance myself from the overall series because I had read 3 of the books in the series already. And the novel as a standalone, I guess, is probably a 4 for me as well. But the series and the more I know about Himes, it kind of has to stand in that 5-star category for me, because I can't just look at the book as a single work anymore. And, you know, for good or bad, that's the way it is. But I love this. I don't have a problem with the slapstick. It works for me. And I understand, especially after reading the biography of Chester Himes, I kind of understand why he does it. My rating has not changed. If anything, I want to read more Himes the more I think about him.
I wouldn't be surprised if we do. There are a few books that have been recommended to me, including his first work, If He Hollers, Let Him Go, which deals with injustice. And that's before he's writing in the detective realm. And then some of the later books in the Harlem Cycle, because there's 9 books in total. I think the second to last or the last one, I think it would be fun to visit down the road, where his views on politics, Himes' views on politics, evolve, and he's dealing with and discussing the Black Power movement in relationship to his 2 main detective characters. And I think that would just be really cool to see some of this history played out in his work.
Yeah, for sure. And I just happened to order If He Hollers today. So
great.
I'm looking forward to reading that one.
Cool. I have it on my shelf right in front of me. So perfect.
Awesome. Well, let's move into a summary of this particular book. So this is The Real Cool Killers, and it originally came out in 1959. It's the second book in these Harlem detective series, or also called the Gravedigger Jones and Coffin Ed Johnson mysteries. But this one starts out, Ulysses Galen is a white man in Harlem. Ulysses Galen is someplace he doesn't belong. Ulysses Galen is soon to be dead, and it's going to be quite a night. We start out in a club in Harlem, and soon Galen is attacked. He flees into the street, bumping into a drunk man by the name of Sonny Pickens. Pickens, gun in hand, chases Galen down the street, and Galen is struck by both a car and a bullet. Pickens is arrested, but a local gang called the Real Cool Muslims gets involved and causes a distraction. A distraction that leads to Coffin Ed shooting a member of the gang. Ed ends up suspended, and Pickens becomes the gang's somewhat willing hostage. Meanwhile, Gravedigger is on the hunt for the killer. Then they find out Pickens' little pop gun shoots blanks. So who's the real killer, and why? Gravedigger's investigation drags us through the streets of Himes Harlem, a den of vice and interesting characters, informants, pimps, and drug dealers, who reveal many twists and turns during Gravedigger's search. The case gets stranger and possibly even darker when Galen might not be so innocent after all, and a member of the Real Cool Gang just happens to be Coffin Ed's daughter.
Great. Nicely done. Very taut.
That's what we're after here on Point Blank. Taut.
Taut. Terse and taut. The less we say, the better. So, before we move on, we want to talk a little bit about the author, Chester Himes. Chester Himes was an African-American writer of crime novels and political polemics, whose primary theme in most of his fiction was racism in the United States, and his primary medium was crime fiction. He was born in 1909 to a middle-class family in Missouri. His father was a college professor and his mother was a teacher. He grew up in Missouri and Arkansas, but his teenage years were marred by tragedy. The big thing that happened was that his brother was involved in a demonstration at a school assembly with some gunpowder. The gunpowder went off and his brother was blinded. Because of local Jim Crow laws, though, the local hospital would not treat him. And this deeply affected Himes' childhood, but also the entire family who was forced to move to Ohio. So in Ohio, Himes enters adolescence. He dabbles in crime a bit. He attends Ohio State for a while. But that dabbling in crime set the stage for some future interactions with the law, one of which involved an armed robbery where he was sentenced to 20 to 25 years in the Ohio State Penitentiary. Now, this experience in prison was informative, and this is where he started his writing career. He began to write short stories, and some of them were actually published in national magazines even then. Writing in prison and being published earned him respect from guards and inmates, and he was eventually paroled in 1936 after serving less than 10 years, really. He met Langston Hughes not long after, and Hughes helped him to make connections with the literary world. Like many of the authors that we've been reading, Himes also moved to Los Angeles to become a screenwriter in the 1940s, and he published one of his first novels, If He Hollers, Let Him Go, which contains a lot of his autobiographical stories and talks a little bit about race and working class struggles in the shipyards of California. Now, he was more popular in Europe than he was in the U.S., like a lot of the authors, Thompson, Goodis, and others. He was one of the few who actually moved to France. He moved to France in the 1950s to escape American racism in part, but also due to the fact that people loved him there. In France, it was when he actually wrote the Harlem Detective novels that we're discussing today. He wrote all 9 of them there. The first one won the grand prize of police literature or detective literature in France. And he was married a couple times, including to Leslie Packard, who was his wife up until his death. As a mixed-race couple, they dealt with a lot of hardships, but these hardships were less obvious in France. And they lived a pretty rich literary life. Himes was friends with Hughes and Richard Wright, Malcolm X, Ishmael Reed. And though he was a contemporary of these luminaries, his work is less celebrated. And we just don't know as much about Chester Himes. And I do hope and I imagine that that will change soon. But politically, he was somebody who evolved in his writing from one of being more pro-state and conciliatory with regards to race and politics. But by the end of his writing time and by the end of his life, he had evolved to being more of a revolutionary, having a pro-revolution stance, and even critiquing the Black Power movement for being not revolutionary enough. So he was an intriguing personality and one that was pretty outspoken, more so than a lot of other Black luminaries at the time. He died in 1984. He was still living in Europe. He's an interesting case, and I'm really excited that we get to learn more about him during this podcast.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, Himes alone, I mean, we could probably spend multiple episodes talking about Himes and all of his different experiences, but from that biography you were just talking about, the things that stand out to me, again, looking at this episode a second time, is his experiences as a kid, the racism that he felt in the United States, and that the fact that, like, he starts out as a kid in a setting where his parents were working at these institutions that were trying to educate and better the African American. And basically, as Jim Crow moved into the South, their lives just got worse and worse. And even moving to the North didn't do anything to alleviate that. I don't see how your perspective couldn't be shaped significantly from those experiences. And then the time in prison, obviously the injuries that happened to his brother, and then the injuries that he himself had when he was working and fell down that elevator shaft, and this time in prison, I mean, just huge, hugely influential on his perspective on life and America as a whole.
And it wasn't like he may or may not have committed the armed robbery, but there's also an anecdote of him being chained upside down and beaten by police until he confessed to it. So it was as if the Jim Crow laws followed him north, and there was no real way for him to escape systemic persecution based on race politics in America. Obviously, this informs his writing. This informs the book we read today, which deals a lot with race in Harlem, but also white Black relations in Harlem in class too, something that really consumed him. And he spent his whole life trying to figure out in the course of his writing.
Yeah, for sure. It's a theme that basically starts his career and ends his career. He never distances himself from the politics. And I think when we say politics here, we're talking big scope politics, not small issues. You know, he is really hitting at the heart of the African-American experience throughout decades here of his life.
And his focus is not unlike a lot of these other authors that we've read, in that you write what you know, you write from the hardship faced as a young person. Look at Cornell Woolrich and his obsession with fate and death and how that permeates everything he wrote. Or Goodis, or Chandler with his obsession with knights and this notion of chivalry and his weird relationship with women. If you read enough of a person's work, you start to see these themes emerge. And clearly Chester Himes has his own, and he's one of the first to deal with race that we've read. But somebody who followed suit, Walter Mosley, is somebody that we'll have to read in the future. He was definitely influenced by Himes.
Yeah, for sure. Within the realm of crime fiction, if Himes is known for anything, I think it is that he is busting through this whites-only club when it comes to the
Yes.
hard-boiled detective fiction. He's definitely breaks through that barrier and does so with a lot of power.
Yes, he's brazen in it. He doesn't meekly cross the line. He's not messing around. He breaks right through that ceiling and he makes himself known. And I think that's part of the reason that we don't know him as well. He wasn't as appealing to the mainstream because he was more revolutionary and more brazen in his rhetoric, and he wouldn't back down and he wouldn't back away from a fight. So that's an interesting part about who he is. And some of the characters he writes about too are really, they really stand out in ways, both in the way that they're named and in their behavior. And it speaks to his own very strong personality, I think.
If there is one thing to say about Himes, it's that he is brazen and that he is pretty much as non-compromising throughout his entire life. And just like him, his characters are often doing that. And let's talk about some non-compromising characters. His main characters in this book, Gravedigger Jones and Coffin Ed Thompson.
Yes.
These are the badass Harlem cops here. They are no-nonsense cops, certainly predecessors to a character like Shaft or something like that. They are taking the streets of Harlem by storm. And it's interesting that they're doing this under the umbrella of the police organization, but yet they don't really like the New York City police all that much. They have this uneasy truce with their own department. They kind of need each other to do what they can to keep the streets of Harlem safe.
I really think that's the coolest thing about this book for me, is that these two badass, almost superhero-like cops, I mean, these two dudes, Jones and Ed, they're the kind of dudes you see get out of their car and you quiver with fear and you run the other way, and it doesn't matter if you're black or white. They instill fear with their massive revolvers and their attitude. They're take no prisoners types. But yeah, this whole notion of working within the system, working within a police system that also is incredibly racist. And there is some cool academic stuff talking about this interesting relationship that I want to talk about later, about the way that they operate within the system. But for now, I'll just say the New York Police Department that Chester Himes paints in this book is not friendly to African Americans. Most of the white cops in this story blatantly use racial slurs and treat black citizens of Harlem like second-class citizens or animals. And it's very clear the kind of terrain that Gravedigger and Coffin Ed are operating in.
Let's just talk about some of those other characters. We have quite a list of names here. Mm-hmm. You know, we normally do our Puss Walgreen Award for crazy character names and such, and Himes could fill a dozen episodes with just the characters from this book.
Indeed.
We have Choo Choo, Sugar Tits, The Sheik, Sissy, Big Smiley, Inky, Bone, Good Booty, Justice Broom, just to name a few.
Low Top, Rubber Lips, Big Greek, and everyone's favorite, Mrs. Helen Krueger.
Yes, as I recall, that is your selection for the Puss Walgreen Award, is it not?
Yeah, I guess we're giving it away early, but yeah, Mrs. Helen Krueger is the only boring-ass Anglo-white name in the book, and it stands out like a sore thumb compared to all these crazy names.
Yeah, and I had initially picked the character Reddy Belcher.
Yes, that's a good one.
Yeah, but any character in here could pretty much be a Puss Walgreen Award for these great names that he comes up with.
Mm-hmm. What do you have to say about this gang, the Real Cool Muslims, and the whole setup for this book?
Well, I do think one of the things that Himes does well is that these names are obviously street names, and we would certainly have that today as well. I mean, you could go back to gangs in New York and have street names, but Himes, I think he captures this period very well for both the names that he's using and the notion of just with the name, the Real Cool Killers and the Real Cool Muslims, like what is culturally interesting at the time. And I think that comes through in a lot of these characters as well.
Yeah, so these Real Cool Muslims, this is a street gang of young Harlem teens, delinquents or whatever, and they dress up like the stereotype of Arabic Muslims with beards and tunics, and they wear these disguises walking around. There's something about disguises in this book that repeats itself. Guys who dress up like nuns, kids who dress up like Muslims. This whole notion of identity and masks seems to play an important role in Himes' thinking. I haven't really figured out what that is exactly, but it's just something that stands out to me.
For sure, that is a theme he returns to. Yeah, I don't know if it's a real deep feeling or if it's just part of this satire imagery that he has of the situation. And, you know, he consciously made this group, the Real Cool Muslims, a satire because he was commenting on the emergence of like the Nation of Islam in the black community well before it became a firmly established thing at the time.
Yeah, because this book came out in 1957 or so. So this precedes a lot of the civil rights stuff and a lot of the black nationalists and black identity movements of the 60s and into the 70s. So yeah, that's interesting to get an insider's on the ground take. But it's funny to say that he's an insider being that he's living in France at the time. And though he writes an entire series, nine books about Harlem. He never lived in Harlem. And that maybe that speaks a little bit to the way that he portrays characters. He has a lot of room to work with because he's not limited by his personal experiences in the city.
That's true. And that's an interesting fact about this series is that he visits the area. He says several things over the course of his life about his relationship with this whole series of novels. And it definitely varies depending on when you asked him. But he mentions that Harlem is basically a fucked up place. And it's fucked up because of the situation that essentially has been created for the Black community there. They had to escape from Jim Crow, and then the only place that they could live in New York City was in Harlem. And then Harlem was so restricted that it created this atmosphere of, I don't know, almost parody itself. At least that's what, in his eyes, what he's looking at. He says, at least in one place, that to understand Harlem, you have to find the humor in Harlem. Otherwise, all you're going to see is the violence. In a way, that's a positive thing for him to be saying, well, look, if we can't laugh, the only thing we can do is cry.
There's sense to that. And I think one of my initial problems with the slapstick is that it felt like Hollywood-y or cartoonish in a way that didn't work for me. But upon thinking about it and hearing that quote you just mentioned, but also John Riley writes that in white society, reason is a chief value, but in Black Harlem, because of racial oppression, slapstick physical action is the norm. Everything's unexpected. You never know when things are going to get bad. And like you said, humor is a coping mechanism as opposed to something just for cheap comic relief. When does a slapstick happen? When a guy's getting his arm chopped off by an axe in a bar, when people are getting shot in the street. We're trying to bring humor and light to really atrocious, really horrifying situations that if we witness them in our personal lives, they would be scarring. But if you see it every day, if you experience racial oppression and injustice constantly, how do you survive? How do you not suicide? One way is to find a way of spinning it, finding the absurdity in it. And that makes this book have much more gravity for me than it did upon the first read.
I definitely think that you can say things with satire that you can't say in a straighter way a lot of times. And I think Himes at least came to terms with that. Himes was known to have said about this series that when he started writing it anyway, that he was writing it for the French market. And he said that, well, you could throw together any kind of crazy stuff and the French would believe it and eat it up and love it.
It's interesting.
Yeah, it is interesting. And what's interesting is that his perspective on this would change because he was actually once known to have called this book, The Real Cool Killers, a cesspool of buffoonery or some strange shit. He didn't really like his own book, but I don't know that he necessarily at first realized what he was, or to the extent of what he was doing, because this series would become very popular with African Americans as time went by, as he got regarded by other notable African American authors. He would go on to think that this was his biggest contribution to literature. And he recognized that this satire, and I guess in his own words, this buffoonery, it was possibly problematic, but he was doing it for himself. He was doing it for his own people. And he says, quote, "I wouldn't do this for anybody but my own Black people." So eventually he came to believe, or the later books in this series were written not for white America, not for the French. It was for African America.
It's interesting how his views evolved. His first audience was France, like so many of these other crime fiction authors we've read. They discount their own crime fiction work, thinking about their own ambitions as a literary author, because that's how he started. He started with If He Hollers, Let Him Go, and he was looking to make waves as a straight literary writer. And he probably discredited his own work until they get shipped overseas and he has an African-American readership. They respect and appreciate his work. And he starts to see that he's documenting these crucial times and commenting in a way that a lot of people are afraid to do. Part of that ability to comment was his freedom. He was in France. He wasn't afraid of cops breaking down his door in Ohio or in Arkansas or wherever. He was liberated from the racial oppression that he grew up with. And that liberation allowed him to use his voice.
He did have to hide from the French right-wing militia for a little while, but that's a story for another time.
Yeah, France is in a utopia.
Well, ultimately, this series and this book, for both its audience and for its writer, is about reclaiming Harlem. And
yeah,
that's really one of the most powerful things that this series does and Himes achieves with his crime fiction writing here. So we've looked a little bit at that setting, the characters, some of the satire involved. What do you see in the writer's craft from this particular piece?
Well, the first standout to me is Himes is telling us if you want to write freely and write truly and you're a Black American, leave the United States. He says, go to France, get out, don't limit yourselves to the American experience, because when you're within that world, you're not seeing things clearly. So that was a major piece of advice he had for Black American writers. Did anybody heed that advice from him more so than from somebody like Baldwin or some of these other Black writers who moved out to France or elsewhere? I don't know. He definitely was illuminated by his time leaving, and it really allowed him to establish himself as a writer. Now, he said some things that are interesting to me about his favorite writers or writers that deeply influenced him. One of them was Dostoevsky, and Haim says he was grateful to him for helping him to understand the process of writing. He said that Dostoevsky wrote very rapidly and very brilliantly because he needed money all the time. And this rang true for Haim, this notion of having to write to pay the bills. And like a lot of these pulp writers we've read, they're getting paid per story, per novella. If they're not writing, they're going to lose their apartments, except for somebody like Gardner, who's rolling in the dough. So Dostoevsky was a model, not because of his writing style, but because he figured out a way to write fast, to write well, and to move on. And that was an inspiration to Himes. Another person who inspired him was Faulkner, which was interesting because I don't feel like their writing has anything in common other than they're rooted in the South. But one of the reasons he liked Faulkner was another practical reason. He says his imaginative stories about the South were invented so fast that if you breeze through Faulkner, you can find any number of mistakes. Faulkner would forget character names, for example. You'd read certain books like Light in August, and by the end of the book, he would forget names of characters that he established at the beginning, and the character names would change. And Himes was amused by that. Again, this isn't a how to write, but I think it's something about these superstars and how they can make these simple mistakes and get away with it. Something about that spoke to Himes. We're all flawed, or there is no perfect craft, and flying by the seat of your pants, writing quickly, not worrying too much about the tiny things. Something about that gave him confidence or inspired him in some way to write. I thought those were odd and interesting and the kinds of things that not every writer would say. They're not exactly self-congratulatory. They're sort of revealing his own confidence and vulnerability.
Yeah, Himes was very good at breaking down what other authors were doing well and then altering it to his own benefit. And I did read Faulkner's Sanctuary, and that is the book that supposedly he carried around when he was starting work on this Harlem Detective series, to the point where he had read it so many times it was dog-eared, beat up, notations everywhere, all sorts of things like that. And after reading Sanctuary, I actually could see quite a bit of what he pulled out of that book. There is a scene in a brothel in that book, which he relies heavily on. I'm not going to say that he stole it or anything, but there's enough things of commonality there. You can see that he read that book, and you can see that it influenced how he chose to write when it comes up in the Harlem Detective series. Another thing I think that you see in Sanctuary is the pacing of the dialogue, the way that Faulkner's dialogue in that book, like, it's there. You're not always necessarily sure why it's there. And I think we see that a little bit in Himes' work in these books as well, where there's sort of random conversations that might, you know, and maybe another author would have gotten rid of or not written in the first place. But they do serve a purpose in that they continue to add to that setting for Faulkner, the South, and for Himes, Harlem.
The lived experience. He's really trying to fill in and layer the experience of Harlem, at least the one that he sees in his head. And he's trying to portray it complexly and dynamically. And sometimes these bizarro conversations that happen, they might not exactly further the plot, but they help with us understanding these individual characters and how the system and how this society sort of works, because it's marginal. It's a black market society. There's a lot of scams. There's prostitution. There's backdoor dealings. It's a shadow society existing under the oppressive boot heel of white American capitalism. And these two dudes, Gravedigger and Coffin Ed, know that. And that's what's really cool about them as cops is that, I mean, Himes made them to operate in the in-between. They're not like arresting prostitutes. They're not out there looking to mess up some number con games, but they are out there to mess with people who are robbing others, who are committing armed robbery, who are con men, conning black folk. So they operate in this middle ground where they have their own laws, like a Western outlaw, in a sense. That's something that's pretty cool about them.
Yeah, for sure. They probably have more in common with that Western sheriff or something than they certainly do with a New York police officer for the time.
This book was written in the 50s, right before the civil rights era. Historically or politically, do you have any thoughts on what this book has done or about Himes in general?
Well, I don't think that you can separate Himes from politics. the writing of his entire life is a political commentary, whether it's the start of his writing talking about his experience in prison and what the life of being an incarcerated person was in the United States for that time, or if it's his later work in this Harlem Detective series talking about the African-American experience in Harlem through the eyes of this crime fiction series. Everything he writes is political. And you can trace, not specifically, but you can see the progression of elements of the African-American political thought as it changes through the 20th century through Himes's work. He was hugely influential to a lot of major thinkers within the community, especially in the 60s and 70s. And as his work became rediscovered, he was ahead of his time in a lot of different ways. And that's why he always had trouble getting published. He always had trouble getting readership. And it wasn't until those later days when a lot of the things that he foresaw started to happen that people looked back at his work and said, oh, wait a minute. This guy really said a lot of things that were pretty much right on, you know, and some of what he has to say is still relevant today. You know, he said that, and this is, quote, his words, the Negro problem will not be solved until the problem of democracy is solved. He said that in If He Hollers, Let Him Go, in the 40s.
Yeah, when he was still living in the States, he was still living in the U.S. then. So he already had this pretty strong political point of view before we moved to France.
For sure. All we need to do is look at some of our elections here and some of the disenfranchisement of African-American voters to know that that's pretty much spot on yet. He was very critical of the standard liberal perspective as well. He talks about how at the time they were talking about desegregations of schools and that sort of thing. And he says that you're not going to change the problem, but there will be a small number that can't change the problem of education for blacks in its entirety. At this rate, it must be 450 years before segregation disappears in its entirety in the South. He's basically saying you can't change some of these issues overnight, but you have to continue to fight and continue to be firm in your beliefs. That's why he needs to be revisited and share the spotlight with some of these other writers on a higher pedestal, not just from his work on the page, but for his thoughts as a person.
Sure. And it's a combination too. It's the fact that he was able to see clearly, that he refused to let his voice be silenced, that he moved to France to further clarify or give himself space without compromising his vision. The fact that while in France, he still stayed in tune to what was happening in Black America, and that he still had, for over the course of his success as a literary writer, or at least as a crime fiction writer, this soapbox to chronicle not just these stories about hardship in Black America in urban settings, but also to capture and distill his beliefs about race and politics and how that evolved to the point where he was quoted as saying he wanted to see organized revolution in the 1970s and the 1960s. But it's not something that he believed was really a possibility. He said that Black Power shit was more realistically capable of non-revolutionary uplift than of total revolution. But this very left, very revolution or bust point of view was not something that he started with. It was articulated and evolved over time. And we see it in these two characters, which is so cool. They're like a time capsule. Gravedigger and Coffin evolve in a way that models or mirrors Himes' own political evolution. That's just so cool to see. And his legacy, if there's anything, it's on multiple fronts. But one is he's the underheralded voice of mid-20th century Black revolutionary America. He saw race so clearly. But we also have these two really cool characters that, while a little slapsticky, while maybe a little over the top, they chronicle this experience in a way that a lot of characters of the time, how many Black characters in the mid-1950s are speaking clearly about racial injustice in the United States to a mainstream audience? Like, that just doesn't happen.
You know, it's interesting that the last book in this series isn't especially well known, but it's called Plan B. And he wrote it in the 70s, and it didn't come out until 1993. But in that book, I guess I'm going to give this away. So if you'd want to, skip ahead a few minutes here. In Plan B, and I'm not going to say who does what, but Gravedigger and Coffin, one of them shoots the other one over their political disagreement and how they see what course of action should be taken. And to end his series like that is pretty powerful.
One of the things I was afraid of when I first read this book was that these two characters were just two-dimensional, you know. They were just going to come in, guns blazing, be all tough, but this false macho toughness, like something Carol John Daly would draw up, to hear that they evolve. And having read A Rage in Harlem, which I thought was a great book, that was the first book in the series, I see a little bit more of these two characters so that I understand who they are in book two, and curious to see, yeah, sure, they might not move too dramatically from book to book, but to see them over the course of 9 pages, and to know for certain that they do evolve and they do take politics seriously. Though they appear monolithic, they are dealing in a really nuanced way, having to balance the pressures of white America, the pressures of a racist police force, the pressures of poor black Americans they have to arrest or put in jail or beat up or whatnot, and also protect, like in this book, rich white people who come to Harlem to get their kicks. And that's one of the other key political things that this book does, which is really interesting. How these two dudes, these two badass black cops, have to protect this rich white guy or have to solve his case, even though this rich white guy is coming in and exploiting their community. So it really deals with heavy stuff in a way that's accessible.
Yeah, and that's probably why the Harlem series became so much more popular than the rest of his work, because it makes it accessible by using the genre of crime fiction.
I think that might be his legacy, his ability to make really complicated, really hard to discuss topics, really taboo topics to a lot of folks, accessible to the mainstream audience in a way that's not just informative, but also entertaining. It's a stroke of genius in his ability to pull that off.
Yeah, for sure. Himes had a strained relationship with his detective series, but ultimately he would call it, quote, my biggest contribution to literature. And I think given some time since his death, that can certainly be still held to be true. This biography that we looked at just came out in the last year. So there's certainly a reason to revisit Chester Himes and see some of his lesser known works back in print. I mean, I don't know. I would strongly recommend any of our listeners who hadn't read Chester Himes do so, because his work, not only does it stand alone, is very powerful, but it's also a story in many ways of the African-American experience during the 20th century.
You can get a lot of his Harlem Cycle. They come bundled in volumes, like volume one features the first three books and volume two has the next three and so on. So it's not hard to get his stuff. And these are pretty short books. They run under 200 pages. So I totally recommend his work. I'm excited about checking out If He Hollers, Let Him Go. And then maybe something like Plan B. Anything else before we move on to Subject Unknown?
No, now that we've filled up at least two more future episodes, we can move on. I think that's our goal every episode, is to at least come out of the episode with two more episodes to do.
Yeah, it's a weird kind of verbal procreation.
Our episodes are breeding, everyone. And it's time once again for Really Stupid Mysteries. This week's mystery, A Few Cool Killings. Murder at the Ice Cream Factory.
A Few Cool Killings is the first book, but obviously there's a lot of room for ice cream flavored mysteries and murders. A sequel would be Two Scoops of Murder,
followed by Double Mint Death.
Ooh. Cookies and Screams.
Ah! Then comes The Rocky Road to Hell.
But don't forget Banana Split, and on that cover would be the head filled with peanuts and hot fudge.
It sounds delicious. Next in the series, Butter Brick Kill.
Aha, with the dash.
That's right.
Followed by another dash, Strawberry.
What about Tutti Frutti Terror?
That's not bad. Cookie Dough Row?
The Neapolitan Necktie?
Or Noose?
But watch out for the Hot Fudge Heat.
Moose Tracks of Blood.
That blood came from the Red Velvet Revolver.
Question is, did the moose kill somebody? I don't know. I'm already riveted. How about 31 Corpses?
A flavor for every day of the month.
That's right. For every death of the month.
But what if you don't like ice cream, Justin, and you want instead just a cold treat? You could look into the next book in the series, The Icy Pop Incident.
Yeah, even if you go dairy-free, you still can't escape your fate. How about Eskimo Pie Execution?
Or The Drumstick Daggers.
Hagen Die.
One of my favorites.
That's pretty good. So after we finish our fish boil noir stories and our Burt Renegade Trucker Mysteries, we'll have to dive into these ice cream killing stories.
Certainly, and there must also be a Burt Renegade crossover where he is delivering frozen treats. So,
yeah, he gets fired from his trucker job because he's non-unionized because of Trumpism politics, and he resorts to getting an ice cream truck to make
ends meet, and he can't escape his fate. He's always going to be involved in some nefarious criminal schemes, solving crimes and whatnot.
Well, I think our ideas for this one have gone a bit cold, so let's move on to Subject Unknown.
We are going to talk a little bit about realism in the fiction of Chester Himes, and realism in fiction in general, particularly crime fiction. How does one write realism well in crime fiction? Do they? Do we even want them to? And I want to discuss the problems I had with Himes, which is the sort of slapsticky, over-the-top,
sure,
exaggerated type of writing. Is that going too far, or is it actually as much real as anything else? The terse,
sure,
lone wolf crime solver. How real is that? What do we call real? And is it really real? And what would it take to write real crime fiction?
Yeah, and this comes as a response to something that was, I guess, kind of a discussion prompt here that we found online. And it just comes from The Guardian. And really all we grabbed was the headline, but it's the truth about crime fiction. Realism would be 1,000 pages long and crushingly dull, admits top writer. So that sort of prompted our thoughts here. Well, does it have to be real, or what is real, I guess?
What do cops do? What do private eyes do on the ground in real life? A lot of times they might be more like the character Gerard in the Highsmith book we read, Strangers on the Train. He was a private eye. We never saw him. He was constantly working behind the scenes. The fact is, if we did actually sit with him, he probably would not be offering us illuminating first-person insights like Phil Marlowe. He would probably just be busy working, eating sandwiches, traveling, struggling, missing clues, making mistakes, finally, months and months and months later, solving a crime. At that point, we would have stopped reading, because that's what real work on the ground looks like. It's not romanticized or made for easy reading like it is in tech. So if I were to criticize Himes for being exaggerated, I wouldn't necessarily say that other writers are more realistic than somebody like Chester Himes.
No, like you said, if we were looking at the real work, I mean, it would be 1,000 pages long and boring. But in some ways, crime really gets solved in one of two ways. Either A, you have the long investigation like we're talking about. And yeah, a police procedural or a courtroom crime drama would be exceedingly long and exceedingly boring if it was realistic. But then we have the other hand of where crimes occur in a spontaneous way and things, let's be honest, police usually solve crimes by stumbling upon something or by being tipped off in the long run because somebody talks. That's usually how things go.
True. And in this book, most of the book actually takes place over like a day. It's all what's happening immediately following the crime. So we're still in the thick of it. We're still unveiling clues and people and hearing out witnesses. Probably not at the speed that it would happen in real life, but it's certainly not dragged out over weeks or months. And if, for example, they don't solve the crime in this first wave, it's probably going to be more in the case of one of those tip-offs several months down the road.
I think that maybe not when it comes to Gravedigger and Coffin Ed, maybe their end of the story is a little less realistic. But as far as when it comes to the side of the criminals, that could be fairly realistic. I mean, a lot of things happen, for lack of a better way to put it, in a series of dumb events that lead to a crime. I mean, one only needs to watch, say, an episode of Cops or something like that, or even for anyone who knows somebody or they themselves have gotten in trouble with the law. Usually it's not this long calculated thing. It's usually some sort of dumb incident that happens.
Yeah, a series of unfortunate events or just being in the wrong place at the wrong time or making one or two small mistakes. Things happen fast and the aftermath can happen just as fast. One thing I thought about when I was reading this early on, something that I thought maybe wasn't realistic, my thoughts have changed, but it was this. Gravedigger and Coffin Ed are cops. They're cops in a very clearly racist police structure in the New York and Himes book. And they are operating in a black community which has been oppressed by racial injustice at the hands of the police force. So I thought, well, that's so bizarre. Why not make these two dudes private eyes, you know, get them out. One of the things I love about Marlowe and these guys is they're operating in their own territory. They've carved out their own little niche between the authority and the crime doers. And I really like that independence. So why aren't these two guys independent? Did you have that similar reaction or no?
No, I don't think that I thought about it that way, but I understand where you're going with this. So keep going.
So I was thinking about this and finally I read this article by John Reilly, and he was talking about Himes' tough guy characters, and he's exploring the race relations and all that. And he says one of the reasons that Coffinhead and Gravedigger Jones need to be police is that they need the protection of police sanction. Quote, if they were private eyes, inevitably they would offend the people who profit off of Harlem's fundamental misery as much as they off of small-time crooks. So here's the thing. If they're private eyes, they're operating at the margins. They don't have the police to back them up. Constantly, Marlowe is challenging the police. He's getting into it with the police. He's pushing their buttons, not the good ones, the wrong ones. He's trying to get them to do right and challenge their ineptitude or their corruption. If two black dudes in Harlem are going to go rogue and go against the police and not have the police sanction, they're going to get killed, essentially, is what Riley's saying. Either they're going to get assassinated from the authoritarian structure, or they're going to get wiped out by some people who don't like that they're messing with the affairs or meddling with the affairs of white people in the city. So they need the police sanction. They need to be in this sort of tense middle ground where they're allowed to carry a gun. They're allowed to represent Harlem, but they also have the law. The law has their backs, essentially, in the case that they get into some kind of trouble. If they get into some incidents with white gangsters, or if they end up having to shoot a white person, all of a sudden they're protected by the law, even if half the department still hates them for being black, at least the law's on their side. That makes sense. It's one of those practical realities that made this book not less but more realistic for me and was an eye-opener.
It is interesting to say that that makes it more realistic. I do wonder if Himes thought consciously about that or not.
It's a good question. He liked Hammett. He read The Private Eyes. If he didn't think consciously about it, I wonder what his model would be. Was there another detective series or crime series that featured two cops walking around and solving crimes? I can't think of any off the top of my head.
No, I can't think of, well, at least anything that would be comparable to what Himes is doing. But he probably did think about this. I mean, there are a number of quotes, which unfortunately I don't have in front of me. But general notion there is that there's this grudging acceptance that the police department needs these two guys to deal with Harlem. And if, as white cops, they're not going to make much headway, they kind of have to give Coffin and Gravedigger a little bit of, in some ways, more slack than other officers to deal with Harlem the way they see fit. The only problem I have with that is, like, it does increase the realism, but is that realistic? Like, my guess would be no. I mean, we'd be in the period here where we're still talking about some of the first black cops, at least the early wave of African-American cops in Harlem, and I would think they'd be under a pretty tight leash.
Raises, again, the question, what sounds realistic from one point of view, isn't necessarily realistic in like a practical reality. Fiction realism and real life realism are not the same thing. Look at the dialogue. Look at the way we develop characters. Look at the way plots are structured and resolve themselves in ways that, while maybe not predictable, there's a lot less happenstance and there's a lot less chaos and there's a lot less folks eating breakfast and contemplating walls in their office while they're at work. You don't see that stuff in fiction, but that's real life. So in the case of these guys, yeah, maybe that's not realistic for the times. Maybe that's a fantasy that Himes concocted, because these two badass dudes would probably not be long-leashed black cops in Harlem in the 50s. But it feels realistic in terms of the way it sets them up to be in the middle ground and operate in the world of law and also the world of crime without essentially getting assassinated for being such badasses. And for that, I think it works. My suspension of belief is enough that I'm willing to go along with them for the ride.
I don't really think you can actually answer this question of realism, because it's all on a case-by-case basis.
Of course.
And, you know, one only also needs to always think of that thing, that truth is stranger than fiction, and that I'm sure we could come up with real-life examples from the same time period that, if you wrote them down on the page, would seem completely unrealistic. So it is something to think about, I guess, as a reader and a writer, just one of those things that never has a 100% answer.
Well, like all of our subject unknowns, they're raising questions more than necessarily answering them. So with that in mind, we've satisfied the initial question. As we read more, it'll be fun to go back and explore some of these notions. When we get into Nordic noir and and see some other minority literary writers delving into marginalized communities and lesser written about communities in crime fiction, I think it'd be fun to revisit this topic and see how realism operates, or if it does at all.
Sure. And, you know, once we've raised more questions than we've answered, I think that means that the show has come to an end. So thanks again for joining us. And if you enjoy the show, you can always get a hold of us on Facebook at Point Blank Hardboiled Noir and Detective Fiction. You can send us an email at pointblanknoir@gmail.com. We really do like to hear from our listeners, and we could use some extra questions for Subject Unknown. That would be greatly appreciated. You can get us on Twitter. What's our Twitter handle again, Justin?
Our Twitter handle is @pointblanknoir is where we are.
I should be able to remember that, but I cannot.
Same as the Gmail.
That's right. And it does help. We haven't had a new review on iTunes, but it does help get some notice to the show. So if you can give us a review on iTunes, we would greatly appreciate that. And
coming up in future episodes, this is episode 6. We've actually already recorded and released by this time episode 7, The Black Mass Boys, and episode 8, David Goodis's Shoot the Piano Player. So the next episode following this one to be prepared for will be Cornell Woolrich's Night Has 1,000 Eyes.
1,000 of them.
A whole lot of eyes, folks. Episode 10 is James M. Cain's The Postman Always Rings Twice. And episode 11 is Ross McDonald's The Doomsters. So read along with us if you like. Let us know if you have any questions or thoughts or high fives for us. And have a good night, folks.
Bye-bye.
Point Blank is under a Creative Commons license. Music is by Justin. Copywritten works are property of their respective authors.